and usually in my presentations, they're a little bit funny and some jokes in. But this is only the next 40 minutes, data, data, data. So it will be not funny. Okay. So just to quickly introduce myself again, I'm Stefan Gens, and I'm the Worldwide Technical Communication Evangelist from Adobe. And I'm doing that for about 2.5 years now at Adobe. And before that, I was running my own consultancy and worked a lot with the translation industry and a lot with technical documentation departments and companies. And then I, at one point, switched to Adobe. And it's a great, great fun to work there. Okay. I looked like I have to stay here closer to the thing there. Just one second. Maybe I put that a little bit away here. Like that. Okay. So, just to give you a rough overview, what we would, what I will talk about. We had a. Don't get scared. I will quickly talk about the survey that we conducted last year, end of last year and beginning of this year, and it was a worldwide survey in many countries. People participated. And then I will talk about the adoption of structured authoring, how organizations have adopted structured authoring over the last 6 years, what is the current trend in adoption of structured authoring, what is the maturity level at companies when it comes to that, does the size of a company has an impact if they do structured authoring or not. There are some interesting findings from the survey as well. Which industries use structured authoring the most? What are the popular XML standards used in the companies? Which DIDA versions are they using? And what are the most important benefits of structured authoring for the people who participated in the survey based on their answers? And then how did organizations achieve structured authoring success? So how did they make that migration successful? We wanted to learn more about that and ask some questions around that. And then content management system usage. What are the workflows that companies have when they use the CMS? How are organizations doing structured authoring using their CMS? And what are the use cases driving synergies for a unified content strategy? And there were some interesting findings as well. And then at the end, I would quickly talk about the journey to chatbots and artificial intelligence and machine learning, what the people who participated in the survey answered there. And a quick summary, and then maybe some questions and answers if you have some. Okay. So we had 2,033 respondents in the survey. So that's a quite big number of people. The total we asked a total of 34 questions. And the total number of countries represented in the survey are 30 countries. So people from 30 countries all over the world participated in the survey. Who of you did participate in that survey? Okay, some. Sorry?
I might have.
You might have. Okay. We had a lot of great prizes, so that was also motivating for people to participate. And a total of 32 industries participated in that survey. So it's a quite broad broad picture that we got there. And the profile of the respondents looks... that really doesn't work with the clicker here. So the majority of participants were actually tech writers, about one-third of them. And about 11% were technical documentation manager. And 11%, and I found that interesting, was executive director or vice president level. 8% were IT managers. Not sure why they felt invited to participate in a technical communication survey, but obviously they had this interest. 9% were UI or UX designers and marketing people. 10% were information developers and architects. 8% were e-learning specialists, and 9% were from other industries, and about 4% of the people said they're self-employed. And interesting was the number of employees in an organization. So when someone participated in the survey, we asked, how many people are working in your organization? And about 50% of the people were working in smaller organizations with up to 500 employees. 8% were working in organizations with 500 to 1,000 employees. Then it goes higher again, 21% working in relatively big organizations with 1,000 to 10,000 employees. And 80% of the survey participants were working in organizations with more than 10,000 employees. So, but we can say that the majority of people were working in smaller organizations with up to 500 employees. Interesting is also in which kind of industries the people work. And about 23% were working in the technology and high-tech sector. So that was nearly one quarter of the respondents. And then it goes through the, many other industries like manufacturing, professional services, engineering, management services, graphic design, healthcare, financial service, telecommunications. And 36% couldn't really fit themselves in into one of these categories and gave some other industry as the base of their work. And the majority of people answering were coming from the United States. So 41% were from the United States and 6% from Canada. So about half of the people participating in the survey were from North America. And then we had a large group of people from UK, then Germany, France, Switzerland, Ireland, a surprisingly high number from India, Israel, and 12% were from other countries, maybe like Poland. And the we did not just want to know where the people are working, we also wanted to know where's the headquarter of your company. And again, about more than 50% were from North American companies, and 15% from United Kingdom, 7% from Germany, then some other countries. So again, the majority, we wanted to make it a global survey. It was available in many languages and around the world. But the majority in the telecom industry seems to be somehow located or associated with North American companies when it comes to structured authoring. So we wanted to know about the adoption of structured authoring in organizations. And we wanted to understand how organizations have adopted structured authoring over the last 6 years. So the thing is, we are doing this survey for many years now. And we the first survey we did was in 2012. And then every year we did that survey again. And we clearly see that there's a structured authoring curve going up. And in this year, it was about 50%. So that means in just about 5-6 years, structured authoring, XML-based authoring like DIDA, really came to a point where it's now about half of the organizations are doing some form of structured authoring. Can be DIDA, can be DocBook, can be customized XML or S1000D or whatever. But about half of the organizations are meanwhile in the stage where they do structured authoring. So when we talk about technical documentation and technical communication, we clearly see that the time where people are doing unstructured content, like in Word or maybe in unstructured FrameMaker or InDesign or whatever, they are going away. Or also wikis or Confluence, and so this is all not structured authoring. And it's really going down that that direction. And XML-based content architectures really catch up. And with about 50%, we have reached a breaking point here in the industry, I think. And in the next years, I'm sure, probably maybe end of this year, we do the survey again. And then we will probably see that this number is going up in the next years as well. We'll probably never reach 100%, but 60, 70, 80%, we will see that in a couple of years, I guess. So we wanted to understand what is the current trend in adoption of structured authoring. And 1,753 respondents answered that question. And about 50% are doing unstructured or non-XML-based authoring. And 43% are doing structured or XML-based authoring, and there's a small group of 7% of the respondents who said, yeah, we're still doing both. So the use case there was probably they have legacy documentation with it, which is unstructured and not really worth of migrating, doing the effort, because the machine is no longer sold or just maintained or something like that. And they keep that old documentation, update it a little bit here and there, and the majority of documentation and every new documentation they're doing in structured authoring and XML. Very often on conferences and discussions with people, I hear that people say, yeah, all this DIDA and XML and structured authoring, that's only for the big companies. Yeah, because you need a big budget for that, and it's expensive and takes a lot of time and effort to migrate content, to train the authors, and so on. And we wanted to understand, is that really true? Is structured authoring really just for the big boys in the industry? And we got some interesting numbers here. So about in smaller organizations with 1 to 100 employees, 70% are doing structured authoring, and unstructured authoring, 23%. And then we see in the second group here with 1 to 100 to 1,000 employees, 11% are doing structured authoring, and 16% are doing unstructured authoring. And then in the larger organizations, we see with 1,000 to 10,000 employees that 12% are doing structured authoring and 11% are doing unstructured authoring. And in the very large organizations with more than 10,000 employees, interesting, 10% do structured authoring and 8% do unstructured authoring. And that clearly shows that in smaller organizations, people are still doing more unstructured authoring, like Word or small wikis, Markdown, whatever. And the larger the organization gets, and the breaking point is about in organizations with something between 1,000 and 10,000 employees, 5,000 employees or so it was, I think, that suddenly changes. So in the very large organizations, the majority now is doing today structured authoring, mostly with DIDA. So it's clearly still the case that structured authoring is adopted faster and more widely in large organizations, and in smaller organizations they still do more structured authoring. We wanted to understand which industries are adopting structured authoring the most. And the result is not so surprising. In the technology and high-tech sector, 26% are doing structured authoring. And manufacturing, where, as coming from Germany, where we have a lot of content management system providers and so, who do structured authoring for 20 years or so, I thought it would be much higher. But only in Germany, it's obviously also not completely the case. In manufacturing, only 6% do structured authoring. Professional services, technical web, IT companies, and so, they 10%, and 53% are some other industries. So the classic sector, manufacturing, where you see a lot of, and engineering management services, where you see a lot of structured authoring when you talk to people, it's actually not so widely adopted. The leader in the field here is clearly the technology and high-tech sector. They're doing structured authoring the most. We also asked a couple of questions around if you do structured authoring, what kind of structure are you using? There's a small specialized group of about 4% who is using ATA. We have 6% doing S1000D, 8% DocBook, 13% are using some other structured language. There was a big group of 41% people who use custom XML structures, and 44% are currently using DIDA, and an additional 31% are planning to use DIDA. So DIDA is definitely leading the pack in this area, of XML standards, and all the other standards like DocBook, and so they're fading away. S1000D, ATA, they are specialized standards, so we can keep them a little bit out because they, yeah, there are requirements in certain industries and so, like aerospace and defense. So this number will probably not change a lot, but we will clearly see that over the next years that the custom XML field, that this will go down, and DIDA is definitely strongly, quickly, and big growing, and it will be for sure the standard for the next years. We also, for the people who answered that they're working with DIDA, we also asked them, which version of DIDA are you using? And we also clearly see a trend here. DIDA 1.1 is fading out. Only 5% are still working with DIDA, and only 2% are planning to use it in version 1.1. DIDA 1.2 is still widely adopted. And the new standard, DIDA 1.3, already 11% have adopted that because the migration from 1.2 to 1.3 is pretty easy. And another 12% are planning to move to DIDA 1.3. So DIDA 1.3 will definitely be leading the field in the next years. And DIDA 1.1 and 1.2 are fading out slowly. Among those people who are working with DIDA, who is working with DIDA 1.2? Okay, who is working with DIDA 1.3? Ah, okay, that matches this trend. And lightweight DIDA, which is pretty new, currently only 3% are using it, and only 4% are planning to use it. So the majority is still going for the big DIDA 1.3 standard. We wanted to know when you're doing structured authoring, what are the most important benefits? And this is quite interesting. This question, and especially the answers and how they are balanced. Very often in webinars, on conferences, when consultants make presentations or so, they always come up with that argument. When you do DIDA and structured authoring and content reuse and so, you will have a lot of savings in translations. And this is always a strong argument to go for structured authoring. But in fact, for the companies who participated in the survey, translation cost savings were the most unimportant factor for them. So that was not the driving factor to go for structured authoring. And the most important factor for the companies was document consistency. So that is the most important factor why they adopt structured authoring, to create more consistent content. And another big important factor was the ease of updating and maintenance of content, and content reuse. Then, less important, publishing to multiple formats more easy, reduce content errors, saving in content development time, and saving in DTP and publishing costs. And DTP and publishing costs, saving on that part, is always an argument that you hear a lot from consultants and trainers and XML people, that you will save on DTP because you don't have to do DTP anymore, you will save on translation and so on. But for the companies, these are not the important factors, which is, if you're a trainer or a consultant, then it might be interesting for you as well, that the expectation that companies have when it comes to structured authoring is not so much about the factors that you hear so often, but more about document consistency and maintenance of content and content reuse as the three most important factors for the companies. So we wanted to understand, how did organizations achieve structured authoring success? And an important factor here is change management. So to sum it up, content conversion is a very important part and starting step. Content standardization, learning structured authoring tools, making a business case to management, and XML understanding. And when it comes to content conversion, people said most important is to educate the staff, to educate the people who need to do structured authoring later, make them familiar with the thinking of structured authoring, clean up and make the existing legacy content as clean and consistent as possible to make that migration more easy. And then use automation and scripts and conversion tables and so on, and outsourcing the conversion process. So most companies are actually using external partners and consultants to do that migration for them. And the learning for them was it's way more consuming than all estimates. So companies decided at one point we want to do structured authoring, but later on noticed, oh, it's much more work than we expected or much more complicated to do. Looking at that part is a very important point if you want to make the content conversion step a success. Then content standardization. People said, one important factor for us, we had to set up rules across the organization, and we needed to get in the buy-in from the writers. And naming conventions needed to be organized, and the reuse, one of the big arguments for DIDA, is easier said than done, because you really have to reorganize how you work with content and standardize certain content modules if you really want to reuse them in multiple contexts. And then learning structured authoring tools. Most companies bought in a trainer for that. They noticed that the tools today are much more powerful than a couple of years ago, and that they can do a lot with them. And learning and practice is the key. So it's not enough to buy in a trainer, sit them in front of the tech writers for 8 hours, and then think that the team is ready to do structured authoring. There's much more involved with that, and it's good to buy in a trainer or a consultant who can accompany the team over a longer time of several weeks or months if you want to make it a success. And then business case to management. That was also an important factor for the respondents, and maybe the biggest challenge that they faced. They needed to demonstrate the return on investment and the cost savings, which is very often not so easy to do, especially when you're not already having such a structured authoring system. We have, by the way, a website, a ROI calculator on our Adobe website, where you can do some cost calculation and get a sheet with the comparison of what you're doing in unstructured authoring, number of hours, time, pages, and so on. And you can use that one as well to do your own cost-saving calculation there. Time savings with content reuse is an important factor for making a business case to the management. And the initial investment is usually higher than expected. So don't underestimate the budget for that. So when you go to your management and say, "Ah, yeah, we can do that very quick and cheap," and later on you go to the management and say, "Ah, we need an additional money," be careful with that. Yeah, and then XML understanding, working knowledge, very helpful, and internet YouTube training videos, very, very helpful. These were two main resources for the people in addition to trainings to get familiar with structured authoring. When companies migrated to structured content, they start with legacy content, with unstructured content. And it's very hard, especially when you're a large organization, to migrate everything in one go. Because often it's not just a technical conversion process, but it also has to be rewritten sometimes, or the content has to be reorganized in some way, because a structure like DIDA has certain requirements how a topic should be built. There should be a title first, and maybe some metadata, then the body, and the body cannot start with anything. There's a certain order to follow in the information architecture of DIDA. So people cannot completely convert automatically, so they continue to do unstructured authoring, and then slowly moving one by one, chapter by chapter in their documentation or whatever the organization of the content is, to structured content. And in the end, they end up with structured authoring. But for that phase here in the middle, what most people said what they want and need is a tool that supports both worlds. So they said, we want to have a tool where we can keep our existing unstructured documentation, and then over a week or two, we go chapter by chapter by chapter and migrate it to DIDA. And question to you, which is the only tool that you can use to do that? Where you can bind both structured content and unstructured content? FrameMaker, right. Yeah, that's the magic of FrameMaker. You can do both unstructured authoring and structured authoring at the same time and even combine it in one documentation and create one output from that. And for many participants, that was a key factor because it made their migration more easy. And they didn't have to, boom, go into the new world immediately, but they could learn it one by one, step by step. We wanted to understand content management system usage in the companies and ask some questions around that. How are organizations doing structured authoring using their CMS? And surprisingly, 47% answered, we use it as a shared repository. So it's not so much about the management. It's more like having that everyone in the team has access to that shared repository. Version control was a very important factor for the people. Publishing, 40%, CMS-based authoring. So in the web browser or something, people can author their content. Like in, I think from the main sponsor, I think they also have a web content management system where you can author in the web browser. We have the same with Adobe Experience Manager and the XML documentation add-on for AM. So people can log in. You just send a URL to the subject matter expert, and they start creating the content and do that in a web-based editor, which is easy to use. And workflow management is an important factor, hosting of content, collaboration with subject matter experts, for example, for review processes, and having the capabilities there. And translation management, and not only 30% said that reporting and audits are interesting for them, which I found interesting because with reporting and audits, you can do a lot of interesting stuff in your content management system. And 6% gave some other reason for that. So what are the use cases driving synergies for a unified content strategy for the companies? What they want to do is content reuse across both both fields. That's cut off, sorry for that. They want to use this one and the same content in both marketing and technical documentation. Let's say a table with technical data. They want to use that in their technical documentation and then pull that table out of that database content, for example, and put it on the marketing website with a small technical data. Sharing of common assets, better search integration across both content worlds, technical documentation and marketing, common taxonomy across technical and marketing content, integrated analytics, and integrated view to show both technical and marketing content together. And this is a part I talked last year here about blending marketing and technical documentation or communication. And for an increasing number of companies, this becomes more and more important. And companies like Intel, for example, they noticed, yeah, we don't sell our server blades with our great marketing video. We sell it with hard facts and technical documentation because that's what the admins are looking at and the CIOs. They go into the technical data, they download the data sheet, they download the technical documentation where they can see if they can replace that server blade easily and maintain it easily. So they started to understand, oh, our technical documentation is actually a marketing asset. And we are selling our products with that, and not so much with a fancy marketing video. This draws some attention to the website, some campaign and so, but the CIO, he makes or she makes the decision based on the technical data. And that means that the technical documentation and data sheets and all that, they are becoming more and more important as a sales asset for these big companies, which is a very interesting trend at the moment. And I have about 11 minutes left, so I'm coming to that last part here. We asked a couple of questions around chatbots, artificial intelligence, and machine learning, and you also heard a little bit about that on this conference. And I'm traveling through, around the world to a lot of conferences, like 25, 30 conferences per year. And on every conference, there's this big talk about chatbots currently. Yeah, everyone is talking about chatbots and artificial intelligence and machine learning. And it's for sure an important topic for the future. At Adobe, we have Adobe Sensei. That's our own AI engine. And we use it, for example, in Photoshop to recognize patterns in an image or in Adobe Stock. So that time where people use metadata to tag images to find them slowly goes away because the AI engine can recognize itself what's in the picture. So you don't need to upload your photo to Adobe Stock anymore and then tag it with all kinds of words that so that people can find that picture. But the AI engine can understand what's in the picture. So when you're searching for man sitting in front of his desk with a laptop, then the AI engine will find the pictures that show exactly that. And that's where artificial intelligence is coming in. And we're also looking at using it in our DIDA CCMS and Adobe Experience Manager, and of course in other tools as well. For example, for content analytics and prediction of content, what you want to write and stuff like that. Okay, but we wanted to understand how important is this big topic that is discussed everywhere actually for the companies. And a surprisingly high number of 72% answered, we have no plans as of now. Chatbots are, we don't care about it. And I found that very interesting because it's so completely different from what you hear all the time. And only 22% are exploring or planning to use chatbot technologies, and only 6% of the companies actually have a chatbot. Yeah, and I found that very interesting because I mean I like that topic, and we together with Ray Gallen and Annie McDowell, last summer we did a nice showcase where we create database content and the chatbot can pull that out from Adobe Experience Manager and give the answers, like a step list and so. And it's extremely interesting technology and offers a lot of possibilities. But in the companies, it's not there yet. 72% is a very clear answer, very clear statement. We don't care about chatbots. Why that is, I don't know. But that's what the survey showed now. And chatbot usage for respondents doing structured authoring. The picture looked a little bit different. It was only 60% who said no plans as of now, and 26% are exploring chatbots and currently using, again, only 7%. So seems to be that structured authoring drives chatbot technology and adoption a little bit stronger than non-structured authoring. And we had some freeform text field, and people could put in some comments about chatbots and AI and machine learning. And someone answered, we hope to provide self-service wizards with that in the future. Someone else answered, initial research a few years back was not helpful. Chatbots are just catching up and getting better, and maybe it will change in the future. Trying chatbots for our knowledge base portal, FAQs, and support tickets. And someone else answered, it's still in its infancy, and it's a long way to go, and probably a few years down the line before we are in a state where we can use chatbots in a proper way, because our content is not ready for that, and we don't have the right content for that. And working on some tagging based on machine learning, but it's very, they are working on some tagging based on machine learning, but it's very rudimentary. That was about artificial intelligence and machine learning. So the comments from the people in that freeform text field were more like, yeah, let's see how it will go with chatbots and AI. We pulled out some recommendations from that, and also based on our own analytics and experience, there's one thing that is very clear. When you want to go into chatbots and want to do use artificial intelligence and machine learning, when you have content that is structured content, XML-based content with semantic elements and attributes and so on, then you can adopt these technologies much faster, and it's much more easy. Because engine trainers, for example, for a chatbot, they can pull the right content much more easy out of structured content than they could do with unstructured content. So if your content is locked away, so to say, in Word or in whatever, then you have a hard time to go into this direction. And structured content helps definitely to create more specific and high-quality engines. So if you're using DIDA or some other XML standard that is defined and clearly structured and semantic, then you have much better success and get much better quality engines for chatbots and related technologies. So, summary. The adoption of structured authoring is at its highest point in the last 5 years. We saw about 50% of the organizations are doing structured authoring. So we have reached a breaking point here this year. Large enterprises have a higher adoption of structured authoring than smaller enterprises. And DIDA is leading the pack among all the XML standards. And document consistency ranks highest among the benefits of structured authoring. That was an interesting finding for me personally as well. And change management approach and a tool which handles both structured and unstructured content equally well is critical for the migration to structured authoring. And the CMS usage is higher among those doing structured authoring. So people who have unstructured content use content management systems much less than people who are doing structured authoring. And the content reuse is driving synergies across marketing and technical content in organizations. And we also clearly see in discussions with our customers that is the main reason why they want to go to Adobe Experience Manager and our DIDA CCMS, because they can maintain the technical content based on DIDA and the marketing content and the assets, images, videos, and so on, all on one platform. And they don't, was a very clear statement from our big customers. They said, we have all these silos. We have a CMS for the web, we have a CMS for technical documentation, we have an asset management and a PIM and whatever, and we want to get rid of it. We don't want to have these silos that can talk to each other where there's some content, there's some content. They want to bring the content on one platform. And this is why we originally, 2 years back, also created that DIDA CCMS, but we didn't create it as a separate CMS. We implemented it into Adobe Experience Manager, which is the leading web content management system among enterprises. Chatbots, artificial intelligence, and machine learning efforts are still in its infancy. And structured content is critical to implementation of chatbots, artificial intelligence, and machine learning. So these were the findings from that survey. And one last thing, I was talking a lot about DIDA. Who saw DIDA World in Adobe DIDA World in 2016 or 2017? No one. Oh, one, okay. So then have a look at this website, didaworld.com. That's the Adobe DIDA World. That's the biggest DIDA conference in the world. In 2017, we had about 2,500 people attending the conference. And on October 10 to 12 this year, we will host it again. Currently, when you go to didaworld.com, you see the 2017 website, and you can register and see all the recordings from all sessions from last year for free. So it's a huge learning resource as well. And yeah, in October 10 to 12 this year, we will host it again and probably have some thousand attendees online as well. It's an online conference. It's not a, you don't have to travel for that. Yeah. So and it's free, so everyone can attend it. Okay. Good. Thank you.
Thank you, Stefan. Questions?
Hi, I'm Maike from SUSE Linux. I do have a question regarding the document format standards. Do you have insight on breakdown, on geographically breakdown? Means is the usage of DIDA differently from the usage of DIDA in US different?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's a very clear gap there. So in North America, DIDA is very strong.
Yeah.
And it's definitely the leading standard there. For example, in Germany, it looks very different. DIDA is growing very fast in Germany, but there's a lot of custom XML structures. So it's historically based because the content management system providers, they were using build like Schema and FCT, and so they were building their own information architectures. proprietary XML standards, so to say. But it's we see a clear trend there that this is changing, and companies do not want their own corporate XML structured anymore. Mm-hmm. They're going away from that, and they want to move to a standard like DIDA because everyone is using it, and it makes it much more easy in many terms, like translation, for example. When you have a custom XML structure, you need to customize your translation tools and make sure that every translator in the chain has the same settings file and filters file for your custom XML structure. When you go to publishing, when you talk about responsive HTML5 publishing or publishing your content to an app, and so this all becomes much more hard when you have a custom XML structure. And companies also in Germany, where custom XML structures are probably like 80-90%, they go away from that because it's just too expensive to maintain their own custom structure there.
Okay, thank you. Second thing is unstructured content. Do you know, do you have any insight how much open source projects are making up here?
Sorry?
For unstructured content, I think the biggest part here that use unstructured content are still open source projects because they somehow need wikis and these things.
Yeah.
Do we have any insight here?
It's not only used by open source projects. Things like Markdown or so, they're also used in bigger companies. But there's also a very clear trend that we see For a certain segment, like in software documentation, for example, there are a lot of people using Markdown or similar wikis and so on. But there's a clear trend away from that. A lot of companies are going to DIDA as well because they can tag their content semantically and use attributes to say, okay, this paragraph is for the audience administrator, and this paragraph is for the audience end user, stuff like that. And this is not possible with unstructured content and Markdown and these languages. So there's also a clear trend away from these pure text systems towards structured authoring. And DIDA, again, there is mostly the right use standard. Any other question or comment? Did you enjoy the presentation? I said, I warned you, a lot of data. So I hope you still enjoyed it and say thank you and say goodbye.
But you guys did laugh a few times. I was paying attention to catch that. I didn't light that, you know, like entirely. Okay, thank you, Stefan. Thank you a lot.
Thanks to you.